It's recording now.
Come on, Boyle. Get down by here.
He said to do it.
Did he? No, I didn't.
He was getting impatient.
Yeah. All right. Everybody was okay. Oh, you were late.
I was up here last and first.
Yeah, but you were up here last.
Okay, can we have the room empty, please?
What room?
And the door closed?
Silence, door closed, shut up, sit still. Next.
Oh, out.
T-shirt over there.
Dave Lee Rock. Hey, guys.
I've been up with girls who are not as pretty as
I just on film now.
Yeah, sure.
No. All these lights are, you know, on the cameras and all.
I don't know.
Just for soundtrack.
This week we're starting the Friday Night Bootleg a little early to bring you a fabulous Halloween night special. Metalheads and thrashers, get ready. This week we bring you Motörhead in words and pictures.
Yes, words and pictures, boys and girls. In the privacy of your own home.
But before we begin the interview, let's hear the claw from Motörhead's latest LP, Orgasmatron.
To the claw.
And then we're back.
No, really.
We're listening to WEJY 97.5 FM, and we're back with Motörhead.
Claws never sounded so good.
Now, each of the band, this is actually a new band.
3 years old.
3 years old. First time for us.
So this last year. Should have been around last year, the year before then.
Right. Why don't you give us a little introduction, you know, tell us a little about yourself.
Okay,
this is Pete.
How do you do?
Hi, I'm Pete.
I'm Phil.
We're playing the band together.
Okay. Do you have any problems with the name? For the latest LP, Orgasmatron.
No,
it's truly orgasmic.
No, I can spell it really well.
Yeah. Who thought of the name?
Yeah, why not?
I don't think anything's wrong with it. Here in the States, the PMRC is jumping down everybody's throat that comes up with something cool.
I thought they were into that.
No.
Sure, everyone likes orgasms anyway.
Because everybody likes orgasms. Why do you think Jesus came to this very earth? Immaculate Conception. Imagine the orgasm mega.
With bands like Rat or Motley Crue, who seem to be more image-oriented than music-oriented, Motörhead seems to be something rather special.
We have got an image.
Yes,
we have our own image.
Yeah. They're horrible images.
Yeah. Would you guys see your lack of a flashy image to be an advantage or a disadvantage?
It's just how we are.
Well, I can't really get a job in Motley Crue, otherwise I wouldn't.
Yeah, we don't have to spend so much money on clothes.
No. I can't be bothered keeping them all clean, all the pastel shades. I mean, black don't show the dirt for ages.
I've got nothing against them bands. I think they're really good bands, but so many bands look like that nowadays. Nobody looks like us. So I guess it's a good image.
If you got like two or three out of Bon Jovi, Poison, there's a couple of more of them bands. I've been seeing them all these lists on. You could just swap them around, don't even notice.
Rat.
Rat, right, yeah. All them bands, you could just swap them over and nobody would know. Half the time. So I figured you couldn't swap any of us.
Los Angeles bands, all the haircuts are exactly the same, mate.
Yeah, you got the rainbow, it's like constant Bon Jovi walking past you.
Yeah.
200 Bon Jovi.
They're still...
Not that I've anything against John, you understand. John's a fine person, loves his mother used to bring a flower every day.
There's still some people that view Motörhead as kind of a sinister black metal band, any replies?
Yeah, tough. What should I say? If they listen to music, and they didn't know who was playing it, maybe they'd like it, right? But if they listen to the image that the media puts forth a lot of the time, then screw them.
They think
they've got a brain anyway.
A sinister black metal band, they're living on another planet, I reckon.
Yeah, we don't sing any of that black metal garbage. We don't sing about the devil and,
cut
the head off the wall. Saw your mother up. We don't sing about
it. I noticed you guys don't have the full stage tonight. It must be a little frustrating. And for you especially, let me have to...
Well, only a little, because I knew what Harpos was like anyway.
I mean, like 11 or 12 years now into this band, Motörhead's never really broke big in the States. Is that frustrating?
Well, it's not frustrating, because it was obvious that it was going to be that way, because we never been able to come over here for long enough at a time. We only do a month and 6 weeks here.
We're all going to change that.
It's been rumored that this album's going to do for you what Eliminator did for ZZ Top here in the States.
I doubt it's going to make us $15 million, man.
It'll make us no good,
stop us walking about in time. No, I think this album's the best shot we've had here so far. It's already sold more than any other album. I just hope that people would listen to it.
Do you think that's...
A lot of people wouldn't listen to it because it's one of those heavy metal bands,
Do you think that the large sales are due to the recent resurgence of heavy metal?
No, I think it's because it's a good album that's been pushed well. But, I mean, I don't know what the stigma is about heavy metal with the business, because it's one of the most popular forms of music in the world. And it's one of the longest lived as well.
It's always been there.
It's been going for years. I mean, the first ones that ever played it was something like probably Deep Purple early on. That's back in 1970, right? Mm-hmm. So what's the beef about it?
Yeah.
There's some of the best musicians you'll ever find playing in heavy metal bands too. Some of them guitars knock the shit out of most of them guys and they're supposed to be better. They're always an international musician and stuff, So I don't understand it, everybody. Listen up.
On the new album, Built for Speed sounds a little like On the Road. What made you change it around?
It's exactly like On the Road. It's the same song.
It's the same song.
Different words.
Different chorus.
Change the words. I sing an amalgamation of both sets of lyrics now to confuse you even further.
Oh. And on that note, let's hear Built for Speed from Motörhead's latest album, Orgasmatron. And remember, you've got it on WEJY 97.5, the only station that matters.
Yes, Reggie TV shows.
You've got it on 97.5 FM, WEJY, and for a special Halloween treat, we're talking to the one and only Motörhead. Brian Robertson was your previous guitarist.
Yes, he was.
And he has said in the media recently that Motörhead had no class before he was in the band, and has had no class since he left the band in the comments.
I suppose that's why he's doing so well now that he's left the band.
Yeah.
And why he was doing so well when I picked him up out of the gutter and gave him a job. Are you sure he said that?
Yes. It's in the new issue of Guitar World.
That doesn't mean he said it.
No.
Yeah, true.
Anyway, I get along with Brian much better when I'm not in the band with him.
We all get along with Brian, great.
And
came to see us at Hammersmith, didn't you?
Mm-hmm. We only hit him twice.
Yeah, Andrew was a good shot, wasn't he?
He only fell over four times.
The thing with Brian is that he doesn't understand about being in a band. He understands about playing guitar, all right? He's a wonderful guitar player, but he has no idea what is needed to be part of the band.
The band is a band.
He didn't try very hard to slot into this one.
Yeah, I've read some older interviews where he seemed...
He always dressed different on stage to stand out, you know, this is me over here, and then over there, you know.
But it seemed to me, I read some of the interviews with him before, and it seemed like he was trying to be, trying to add
guest
something. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Well, okay. Too bad for Brian, he's guest artist with the support band on the Bob Seger tour now.
Well, no, it always seemed to me like Brian thought he was doing the band a favour.
Then he wasn't really, because when you get on stage and the guy starts the same song three times...
What's it like?
A favour, is it?
I like him, he's a nice guy.
He is a nice guy.
What's it like having two guitar players in this band now as opposed to one?
Well, they're much shorter, you see, so...
I've been on stilts for the audition. He wants to have a photograph taken on the telephone, but...
Right about your ages. He said he was older, he said he was younger, it was great.
Okay, now it's time for some raunchy fun. Each of you, one at a time, tell us your favorite road story. And remember, we can edit out anything later on that we need to edit out. So,
should we carry on with the rest of the conversation? Go on then.
I said that.
What about Sydney, me and you, me and Phil, with throwing buckets of boiling hot water from the 11th floor, I think, on the passers by.
We were bored, it was about 4 o'clock in the morning. nobody walking dogs, like, they don't believe in cruelty to animals.
Truly the people we believe in.
There's human beings, like,
it's great,
they were
steam going down all the
way. Well, come back and hold in, you got another one.
How about you, Lenny? Any road stories you'd like to tell us?
I wouldn't like to tell you any, but if you're asking for one, I will.
I'm asking.
I once got this young girl in Rochester, New York.
Oh, yeah.
And the place next to the gig was like, the roof came right down to the ground, right? Because it was set down in a dip. And I was looking for somewhere to be, you know, alone in the heat with her. So we went up on this roof and he was behind the chimney stack with our trousers on our ankles. And suddenly five torch beams hit me, the fucking rug crew all there. So we climbed down out of there, bastard and all that, you know, and we got back into the gig and then we were getting hot again, so we went out looking for another place. So we avoided the rug crew this time. We ran to a weed patch at the back and like thrashed around in there. And for the next 2 weeks I was smothered in Zaladril, right? And these great red things or something poisonous in the back. Ah, absolutely wonderful. It was a true religious experience.
Are there any plans for...
There's road story.
My favourite one in Finland, where the lighting crew decided to have a party. So we took all the furniture out of that room, everything that was in there, put it across the way in another room. We all moved over there. By this time, the rest of us had joined in, having a good do. One of the guys on the lighting crew got really drunk and decided he wanted to be alone with this girl.
That's right.
So he crept in a wardrobe, and somebody saw him creep in, and so when he was in, they turned it round and put the door to the wall, and he couldn't get out, so he thought, well, what the hell, I'm in here, I might as well. And she stooped to do something unspeakable. And she was that drunk, she was sick all inside his chair.
So he's trapped in there, right? It's pitch dark, he can't get any room. There's terrible fumes, right? You can't even put your pants up. Crack through the back of the wardrobe to get out of it. Come out through the back, that's right, I forgot that. That's beautiful.
I have a little Belgium, I've got the night, I mean the morning after the night before. I had a terrible hangover and this chick says, I'll drink this tomato juice, it'll make you feel better, so I'll lift that down. I could feel it coming up, and I flew up in bright red, all over the carpet. And then Roger was going to throw us all at the hotel.
Feels like a lung hemorrhage.
This isn't technically a road story. It happened on the first day we recorded Orgasm, a fun album. First time, as we began with Bill Laswell and Jason Cassaro, and this old lady came up to me, and she was saying, are you Phil? And I thought she was... something to do with the studio, like the owner's mother or something. I said, yes, yes. All of a sudden, she opened her fur coat like this. She had 62-inch boobs, right? She pushed me right down in front of her, started singing songs in my ear. And she took off her leotard, and she was hitting me with the right boob, like, singing on top of her voice, and it was level paid for a grotogram.
cost him about 35 quid. Bill Aswell, he's trying to get the drum sound together with Jason, like he's only just been in a few hours, he's turning around. This woman's singing these songs like an enemy with a tits.
On that happy note, let's hear Ace of Spades from the Ace of Spades LP. We're back on WJY with Motörhead.
Yes, we are.
And I would like to ask you guys, are there any plans for videos or anything like that from the new album or tour?
If people offer us money to make videos, sure, yeah.
You mean record company?
Do you know them? No, I was thinking of J.C. Penney's money.
Salvation Army.
McDonald's have offered us to do a deal for as long as there's burgers in the video.
We're going to have motor burgers with razor blades in them.
For Halloween.
Why not? Trick, that's the trick. The treat is we get you hospitalized.
Just out of curiosity, Lenny, what was the first song you wrote and how did that come about?
First song I wrote was The Watcher. Because I was speeding and couldn't go to sleep, so I thought I'd do something, so I did that. I've been thinking about flying saucers, I was impressed.
When you
a lot of my songs are actually about the hopelessness of the human race, you know. I mean, we don't deserve anything, and we didn't even deserve the wheel. You know, I mean, we don't deserve anything, no preferential treatment. And I'm quite sure that the human race is going to go poof one day quite soon, and there's nothing we can do about it, that's what I believe. But you mustn't lose your sense of humour, you know.
When you write a song for Motörhead, do you ever feel constricted by the band's style?
No.
He doesn't write all the songs anyway. We all write the songs. We're pretty straight on that, folks. Len writes all the lyrics.
And that's right. Because nobody sums things up quite as well as him in one sentence. Just paid me $50 to say that.
No, I haven't paid you yet.
We don't go in with any ideas about it. We just thrash it out. We have long periods of inactivity. It's a big word there, boys.
Mm-hmm.
And then we decide, right, we're going to work, and then we go in, and everybody gives 479% effort, and we get things sorted, and then we stop and don't do anything for days. And then when we decide, we go back in again.
So I've been growing up and being a mother.
There's no preconceived ideas. We're not going to write a hit single now. We just write songs as they are.
Well, we don't write unless we've got something to write it for. It's not working, is it?
No.
Now, I noticed you guys are touring with the Cro-Mags.
Yes, I noticed that.
A lot of people would consider them a hardcore band.
Yes, they would. I wonder what that is.
Wow.
Said long hair.
And would you guys consider yourselves a metal band or a hardcore band or a hybrid of the two?
I consider us Motörhead, really.
We just play rock and roll.
We don't care about Motörhead. The categories that people have to use about us in order to make it easier for them to find the rack that we fit in.
Yeah.
I couldn't give a shit about
this is
that.
Motörhead,
but if we're Motörhead, we play what we play. If you like what we play, if you hear it, come and see us. If you don't, get out of here, you know. I don't give a damn.
And with that, let's hear the title track from the band's latest LP, Orgasmic.
Oh, good, which one? Jimmy Swaggart, this is your life.
You're listening to WEJY, and we're back with a WEJY exclusive, Motörhead in their own words. You guys have a very loud sound on the album. What kind of setting do you use live? Are you...
Everything on 14.
Everything louder than everything else.
Yeah, that's our motto. In fact, we've got t-shirts that says so.
I heard a rumor that you guys had played some places earlier on this tour where the stage was collapsed.
That's rubbish.
Not true.
Played in 84 with the ceiling collapsed.
Cleveland,
Ohio.
That's what it was. What happened there?
The ceiling collapsed.
Was it because of the volume?
Yeah, I think so. There was no ceiling.
I don't know. There may have been people dancing up there. I didn't see them go up the stairs.
We got the blame for it anyway. They unplugged us during the last number. So
I think it was the promoter of the pickaxe. He wanted the insurance, you know. Trying to sue us for it too, right?
Mm. Let me, if you had to describe this band in one word, someone who had never heard of Motörhead, what would it be?
Upstanding.
Why?
Why not?
Can we stand up?
Can we stand up and play? No, all right. Reptilian, you know, I mean, prehensile.
Rapscallion.
Prehensile, that's a word, yeah.
That's a word, isn't it?
Who can spell prehensile? First 10,000 correct answers get through in the pocket.
The word Motörhead is also slang for someone who does a lot of speed. You guys party a lot?
Not necessarily. It's also somebody who load of mouth.
That's
talks
true.
A lot.
You guys, to do
it's also somebody who drives very recklessly.
Yeah.
Yeah. You guys party a lot, though.
Oh, we do, don't we? We don't get a chance to run with the bus, we do.
We would be now if we weren't doing this interview.
We find that 15-year-old girls are scared of us these days, whereas in my youth when I was prettier. I used to get 13-year-olds and the bodies of 8-year-olds sometimes.
You were the only member that's with the band now that was in a band when they did covers of ZZ Top, Beer Drinkers, and Hellraisers.
Oh, that's
and,
right.
The Yardbirds, Train Kept Rolling, and the Kingsmen's Louie Louie.
And the Birds leaving it.
Yeah. Were they done to please the record company, or were they just songs the band like?
Songs that we liked when we first started here to beat it up with a rim and write much.
We don't do anything to please the record company.
Yeah, we don't do anything.
We don't do much to please us either.
Yeah, right.
You still play any covers live?
No.
Nothing? Okay. Is,
We were going to cover, what was that Denise Williams number? Remember, we were going to cover that, right?
Old Man River. With
Old Man River, yeah.
Is,
White Christmas. White Christmas.
Are you on nothing?
Is Stay Clean an anti-drug song?
Yes.
What made you write that?
Because I'm anti-heroin.
Oh, anti-heroin.
We're all anti-heroin.
We're all anti-heroin.
If anybody finds out we find out heroin, we kick them to death.
Depending on how I feel, I'm sometimes anti-Alice.
Anti-heroin, I hate my brother.
Yeah, pizza the rabbit food.
Pete, you used to be in Saxon.
Oh my God. Yeah. Quite proud of it.
What are the advantages and disadvantages comparing Saxon to Motörhead?
The advantages are I get on with these guys and I love playing in the band. The disadvantages are that I've not been paid my royalties yet from Saxon.
Plus, he's fed up with playing with all-girl band.
I know what you mean. I saw
Saxon. How the devil are you?
What type of crowd do you like better, the headbangers or the stage jumpers?
Capacity.
Capacity and bumper. People pay the money.
But a lot of people here at Harpos are going to be skinheads and doing stage jumping and slam.
They have a job to get up there.
No, we aren't too keen on that actually. No. I mean, it's a bit ridiculous.
I don't mind, there was a lot of stage jumping. I don't mind stage diving actually, I don't mind that at all really. As long as they don't bash into the mic stand when I'm trying to sing, because these teeth cost $2,500, right?
Mm.
And if anybody throws anything on the stage when we're playing, we go, we leave, we don't come.
I had a big firework thrown at me at Donington Festival.
I had a knife come across the stage once and someone said,
I heard about that.
But it ain't fair, you know, I ain't going to put up with it, and I don't like being spat on either. I mean, if any of that shit happens, we're just going to leave.
Where's that lobster thermidor thrown at him?
It's a fried egg on top.
And last question for Lemmy. How did you get the name Lemmy?
I don't know. It was an accident, really, I suppose. I never found out how I got it. I tried to make a joke out of it a few years ago. I said, Lemmy quits all Friday. I had these T-shirts made up and it's been backfiring ever since. That's what you wanted me to say, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And now it's got up to Lemmy well, 20 bucks.
Your last question was rubbish. Because I've said it in 10,000 interviews and you should have known that already. Yeah. I think you asked me the same question in the interview last year. So one wonders why I didn't have
the question.
An update.
They're all the same questions.
The paper just gets yellow. It's the same question.
Well, you shouldn't keep it in your trouser pocket.
What's she doing up there?
Any last words?
Look, dinosaur.
Said.
Who's buying the drinks?
Swazi one.
You can start frying your drinks and catch well and go.
How about cacophony? What?
That'll work. Thank you very much.
Here it comes.
an oldie. Some of you older people might remember.
Thank you.
this one is one of the four songs we did on the No Remorse album on this new lineup, right? This is all about a rapist, which isn't cheap these days, is it? Stick with it. David Coverdale. First girl over to front of Andy Donington. Well, does anybody know any jokes? Well, don't tell me you want to. Don't be a minute now. Any second now. This one is another one from our new album. How many of these sons and bitches went out and bought it? Oh, almost 10 of you. Well, could the other 10 go out and get it? Because we need the fucking money, you know what I mean? I ain't getting any younger, I've got to get some blue cross for fuck's sake. Forever.
Get out! I'm leaving here! This is the sign!
If you're looking for career opportunities, here's one that you won't get in school. I strongly advise you all to become rock and roll bass players. That way you can look young and beautiful like me, and have absolutely fuck all to spend with your mates. And you can get laid with it. This one is dedicated to all of you. And especially to me, it's called No Class.
Thank you.
he says. Because we can't fit it in here, you see. So if you buy our album, buy all the back catalogue as well, we'd love it, you know, and then we'd be big stars, and we'd play in the Combo Arena and bring a fucking great big stage show for us. This one is called Bombo.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, well, we're gonna like edit an intro in so we don't have to start everything with the questions. Now, last time you guys were here, this was a completely different band.
No, it wasn't.
Well, not completely
last
different.
Last time we had a different drummer.
That's, well, that makes it a completely different band, really.
No, it doesn't. It makes the drummer different.
Yeah.
It makes the quality different.
It's 25%
different band. One person different makes it a slightly different band.
Yeah, it changes
the
whole.
Two people different makes it a 50% different band. Three people different makes it a very different band, and four people makes it a completely different band.
I didn't see you going to be in for a hard time tonight.
That is the scale on which that works.
Again,
so that's the first question out the window. Do you have any amendments to make to the first
one? What brought about the change? What was the scuttlebutt behind that?
He had various reasons. He'd been with us. We had 3 good years with Pete. He's a great drummer.
Yeah.
He's a great guy.
Yeah.
He just decided he wanted to leave. I'm not sure what he's doing at the moment, and when he did leave, we asked Phil to rejoin, and Phil said yes.
He
did you guys have some like intense rehearsals or what?
Oh yeah, sure. I mean, 4 days, we had four,
ten,
5 days.
Yeah.
The 10, yeah.
10 don't play fantasy
publicity. Yeah, it took a... Somebody else could have done it, apart from Filter, because he knew all the old songs, so we never showed him the new ones. Yeah. We just had enough time to show him the new ones. It's a good job.
It's basically the same set you're playing in the last show.
Yeah. Yeah,
you guys have a much bigger turnout, I think, than I did last time.
Well, and the last time was Alice Cooper and Joe Collins in both in town.
Oh, yeah.
But we signed on Phil Collins, I would have gone to see him instead of playing.
I know for sure Alice Cooper was in town. No, Alice Cooper and Kiss, wasn't it?
That's right.
That's right.
Yeah,
we
right.
We followed
yeah.
him round, or we were following yeah. each other round. Pardon.
He was going to fight to me during this interview, wasn't he?
Was it?
He was going to fight to me during this interview.
No. Could be a ring.
Could be a ring. Oh, no.
Well, we all know where the best show was that night, right?
Sorry?
We all know where the best show was that night.
Where? Alice Cooper. Oh, yeah.
Over here.
The show was on this bus
later.
Yeah,
I thought we had a good
tune. I
last. Yeah, it was
all
those
like,
last 3 quarters, wasn't it? 3 quarters?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the album's really been doing well, especially around here.
It's doing good up in Detroit, Chicago, yeah.
Yeah, and I've already noticed, like, 50% more people were here right at 8 to get in the door and get a good seat.
Really?
Then
next time you're walking along the beach and you